study circle team for the 93rd session on evolution of law, appeal against judgment and orders. The resource person for today's session is Mr. Sri Charan Rangarajan, advocate, former AAG of Madras. I now call upon Mr. Imme Varman, advocate, Madras High Court, to render the welcome address and give
a very good evening to one and all. Thank you to each and every one of you for being here with us today. We are very pleased to welcome those of you who have been with us for this long time, as well as for those who are new joined this group. Before we get started, I would like to express my sincere appreciation to all who generously helped us to make this event come together become a success. For today's topic, we have Mr. M. Sri Charan. And Mr. Sri Charan has completed his Master's of Law in Law and Global Economy with New York University School of Law, specialization in U.S. and Asia's business trade laws, National University of Singapore. Mr. Sri Charan is an advocate with over 15 years of experience practicing before Honorable Madras High Court, Madhya Bench, NCLT, and other forums. His area of practice mainly include company law, constitution law, arbitration law, civil laws, corporate and commercial laws, including insolvency and bankruptcy laws and intellectual property laws. He has rich experience of handling litigation, arbitration, and corporate advisory works for leading companies. He has a notable appearance before Honorable Madras High Court and Honorable Supreme Court matters involving questions of various laws. He has advised several corporate houses on intellectual property laws, such as acquisition, private equity transaction, transactions involving and subject to Securities Exchange Board of India. In 2013, he set up an independent practice in Chennai and founded Sri Charan and Gautam Law Chambers. In 2018, he was appointed as the additional government leader of the state of Tamil Nadu before Honorable Madras High Court. Subsequently, he was promoted as a special government leader, civil suits and arbitration, to defend the state of Tamil Nadu in civil, commercial and arbitration matters. From August 2020 to May 2021, he was the additional advocate general for the state of Tamil Nadu in the Honorable High Court of Madras and Madurai Bench. He also held full additional charge of post of government leader, Madurai Bench of Madras High Court. Sri Charan has been involved in international and domestic arbitrations as arbitrator, and he still continues to appear before Honorable High Court of Madras in the principal seat at Chennai, in addition to the Madurai Bench. Now I request Mr. Sri Charan to take over the session. Welcome, sir.
Thank you. Thank you for the warm words. I'll ensure that the next time that my colleague circulates a shorter version of my resume, that I'm sorry for taking time on a Friday evening about the introduction itself. Before I commence the session, I also wanted to take a minute or two. So the first things first I wanted to assure was, since this is a session on a Friday evening, I already know how taxing it is going to be on all of us from the bar, especially after finishing a long day at court, although not physically in court, which we all miss, but virtually as well. So my first promise is going to be that I will try to wind up in the next half an hour, 45 minutes or so. So I hope that it's a sharp and a crisp session. Now, before I start the topic, I also should thank the study circle for doing a wonderful job for organizing all these meetings. And the reason I say I owe a big thanks to the study circle is also because while I was wondering about the topic of which Mr. Om Prakash had earlier suggested, and I also assured that I would prepare on, I went back on my word and I because he gave me the liberty to do so, and finally picked this topic for today because I thought it was more relevant and more topical at this point in time. And also we are talking about the basics. So I thought, let me try and look at a topic which is more basic, but at the same time where it would appeal to, I'm using the word appeal yet again, which would appeal to all friends of the bar. Now, while I say that, I'm also cautious, and I understood while preparing for the topic and also otherwise when I had appeared in certain matters in relation to these topics, I believe that this topic would appeal to each and every one of us simply because of the fact that the practice area, whichever practice area we may be in, I feel this particular area is a gray area as such, and that means that there is more scope for work. So I thought that let me try and tickle that particular part for every one of us here today. And while the endeavor is to throw the canvas open, I also know I am at a risk because there is no one clear answer at the end of the session. That is why I said I have to thank Study Circle, because the first things first, it says it's a meeting, it's not a lecture. So I'm grateful for that, because at the risk of exposing myself and my capability, I thought we will deal with the topic. Now moving to the topic as such, where the topic reads as the evolution of law appeals against judgment or order. And how am I going to cover that in the next 30 to 45 minutes? It's going to be a Herculean task. So the understanding, or rather the endeavor, is to start off by saying that, yes, we will be trying to cover the procedural part of it in terms of what kind of appeals lie in our High Court. And for that, we have to take the procedural law into consideration, which is, of course, the Code of Civil Procedure and the letters patent, which is applicable to our High Court. Now, in that endeavor, we are going to travel through 150 years and finally land at a point where, you know, it's a point, it's a no man's land where we may or may not find answers. But that's a good thing for all of us lawyers, I feel, because that means that we have a scope wide open to argue on both sides. Now, the first slide, interestingly, we framed it as what is an appeal? Now, if it is going to be about appeal itself, interestingly, appeal has not been defined in the Code of Civil Procedure. So therefore, we take inspiration from the Halsbury laws. Now, what does the Halsbury laws say? An appeal is an application to a superior court or tribunal to reverse, vary, or set aside the judgment. Now, these are important words, because we'll be talking about this throughout the session. At the end of the session, of course, I'm open for questions, and hopefully I try to find answers. The judgment, order, determination, decision, or award. So we are talking about five nomenclatures, five words being used in the Halsbury laws, of a lower court or tribunal in the hierarchy of courts or tribunals on the ground that it was wrongly made, or that, please note the point where we have underlined in bold, as a matter of justice or law, it requires to be corrected. Now, the right of appeal itself, which has not been defined under any of the provisions of the code, we can find that the right is conferred by a statute, of course, which we are all aware of. Now, if it is going to be a mere practice or a procedure, I think the session itself would be redundant. Moving on, let's first try and understand, next slide please, the appeals under CPC. Now, I'm not going to strictly address on what are appeals and what are the kind of appeals under CPC. Now, this is just illustrative to understand as to what are the kind of appeals that CPC contemplates or talks about. It talks about appeals from original or appellate decrees, and it says under section 96 with respect to a first appeal that an appeal shall lie from every decree passed by any court exercising original jurisdiction. Now further, second appeals is discussed under section 100, which talks about the second appeal to a high court if the, of course, the first appellate court is a subordinate court to that of a high court. Now the reason what makes it interesting, or rather this discussion, what should be interesting, is this part. Now, appeals also lie from orders, and an appeal lies from orders which are defined under section 104, but that is an enabling provision. And where do we get the answer as to what are the orders from which appeals lie? We'll have to look at order 43 of the CPC. Now, again, I'm not going to go in depth with respect to what are the kinds of orders which are appealable under order 43. Now, the interesting part is the next bullet. Except as provided under CPC, no appeal shall lie from any order made by a court in the exercise of its original or appellate jurisdiction, but where a decree is appealed from, any error, defect, or irregularity in any order affecting the decision of the case may be set forth as a ground of objection in the memorandum of appeal. Now, this is as regards section 105 is concerned. Now, we'll move on to the next slide. Next slide, which is about section 104. Now, why, before discussing section 104, we should also be aware that all of us know that there was a section 100A which came into being under the Code of Civil Procedure by way of an amendment in 1976, which was slightly different in 2002. Now, the reason I talk about 100A is because that is the first place where the exclusion starts happening as regards the letters patent appeal. Now, while we have that at the back of our minds, we can see that section 104 talks about the order from which an appeal lies. Now, these are the following kinds of orders which have been expressly provided under section 104. For example, an order under section 35A, an order under section 92, which is like a trust suit where a leave to institute a suit has not been granted, so on and so forth. Now, The crucial part, as I mentioned in the earlier on, is 104.2, where it says no appeal shall lie. This is the part where I'll be concentrating on. No appeal shall lie from any order passed in an appeal under this section. Now, in the first slide, we saw with respect to the Halsbury's law's definition, with respect to an appeal, we saw five words or nomenclatures being used in tandem. That is, for example, it could be a judgment, it could be an order, it could be an award, and so on and so forth. And also includes the words decrees. Now here under 104.2, it says no appeal shall lie from any order passed in an appeal under this section. Next slide, please. Now under order 43, because the other appeals, or rather appeals which are available under the Code of Civil Procedure, read with section 104, we get it under order 43. Now the first part of order 43 talks about the appeals from orders, and it also traces the source from which it gets the power to say that it is provisions of section 104. I'm sorry, the font is really small. It may not be as visible, but it merely captures as to what are the kinds of orders which are available and which are appealable under order 43. For a moment, if we can we enlarge this? Or I will just read for the benefit of all of you. Order 43, Rule 1A talks about an order under Rule 10 of Order 7. And let's forget for a moment that we are talking about specific numbers, sections, etc. I'm only on the principles and first principles. Order 10, an order under Rule 10 of Order 7 is with respect to a return of plaint. Now this says, Order 43 says, an appeal shall lie from such an order. That is, if the court decides to return the plaint, that is to speak that the court which is trying the case does not have jurisdiction, and it returns the plaint instead of rejecting the plaint, to be instituted or presented before a proper forum, then it says that that particular order is appealable. Let's have this at the back of our minds. And we are just going through as to what is provided under law so far to understand the lacuna, or rather the gray area that exists as of today. Now, the crucial part with respect to today's topic, I would call this particular three words being of a lot of relevance to all of us across all areas of practice. Now, a decree, order, or a judgment. Now, a decree has been defined as a formal expression under section 2.2 of the code. Again, the crucial words being of adjudication that conclusively determines the right of parties. So a decree has to be of such a nature that it is adjudicated upon. That is, the matter which comes before court has to be adjudicated upon, and it has to finally and conclusively determine the rights of parties with regard to all or any matters in the controversy. Now, this is what decree says. So of course we know, so what's new in this? Why this session at all? Because I will only read the last part of this particular slide, which says that even a rejection of a plaint, because it results in a decree, it will also be constituted under this section and form part and parcel of this section. Now, why does this particular word gain significance? Because earlier, in the earlier slides, we saw as to appeals from two particular words. That is, appeals with respect to decrees, appeals with respect to orders. Now, this is what is contemplated under the CPC. Now, we do not talk about appeals from judgments. Now, this is where the tricky area lies. Next slide, please. An order is defined again under section 2014 to be a formal expression of any decision of a civil court, which is not a decree. So an order is something which is not a decree. Now what is judgment? Now judgment is defined under section 2.9 to be a statement given by the judge of the grounds of a decree or an order. So we have four words here that we have to contemplate and think about: an appeal, an order, a judgment, and also a decree. Now, with respect to an order, they distinguish it from a decree, saying anything which is not a decree and where there is a conclusive determination, then it is an order. A judgment is a statement of reasons which is given by the judge based on the grounds, and it could be with respect to a judgment or it could be with respect to a decree or an order. Now, if this is not more confusing, let's get to the confusing part. I will break it down in simple words in the course of this meeting, where we can understand an order to be something which is not final, but is something which is decided by the court on its way to becoming a decree. That is how I would understand an order. Now, a judgment is like a triangle, and which will connect the dots between the order and a decree. A judgment could be with respect to an order. A judgment could be with respect to a decree. But under Section 33 of the Code, interestingly, it says the court shall pronounce the judgment after the case has been heard, and on such judgment, a decree shall follow. So the way the court has understood a judgment to mean, in contrast to the definition section under, and in particular Section 33, is to say that the court will pronounce the judgment after the case has been heard, and on such judgment, immediately a decree shall follow. So it does not contemplate a situation with respect to an order as such under Section 33. And it says, it is as provided by the CPC, a judgment is a statement or statements given by a judge in support of an order or a decree. Now, this is what I meant by saying, this is kind of a contrast, because if the definition section says the judgment could be with respect to an order or a decree, Section 33 specifically says that post the judgment, a decree shall follow immediately. Now, having this CPC in mind, what is relevant to our High Court, the Madras High Court, which is also one of the chartered high courts, we've incorporated the letters patent. We will just go through a few slides perhaps to understand how these two are interlinked and how the gray area emerges. Now, the history of letters patent is that in 1800, like all of us know, there was a Supreme Court of Madras, which was established under the Royal Charter. And this was by virtue of the Government of India Act, as it then was. And of course, the Government of India Act 1800 and subsequently in 1858 has its impact in the Constitution as well. Now, we'll leave that for a moment. Now, what happened post 1800 when this Supreme Court was established is that post the revolt of 1857, the government, which was in existence then, gave the control and transferred it to the Crown by the Government of India Act 1858, which replaced the 1800 Act. And then came the first letters of patent of the Madras High Court, which was issued on 14/5/1862, pursuant to the Charter. Now, under Section 8 of the Charter, the Supreme Court of Madras and the Sadar Adalat Court, which was there for Madras as well as Calcutta also, and the other presidency court, was abolished, and the High Court of Madras was established. Now, this is only to show how the letters patent came into being. Now, the letters patent in 1862 was thereafter revoked, and a new letters patent came into the picture in 1865. Now, this is the relevant letters patent, which is incorporated, and I would say there were three parts to the letters patent, especially with respect to Clause 15 of the letters patent in relation to appeals, but there is only a small part which is relevant for today's discussion, which we will talk about. Now, of course, the High Court itself was established with all these jurisdictions and for the administration of justice under the Madras Presidency. The letters patent appeal. Now, this is where the entire discussion today takes relevance, gains relevance. The High Court exercises ordinary original civil jurisdiction, as we all know, and that is by virtue of Clause 12 of this letters patent. Now, under letters patent Clause 15, the appeal shall lie in respect of an intra-court appeal from the original jurisdiction of the High Court to the appellate jurisdiction. Now, of course, we know that it is from the judgment of one judge, that is a single judge of the High Court, to a division bench. Now, where do we trace this power? It is to Clause 12 and thereafter Clause 15 in terms of appeals. Now, the portion, like I earlier mentioned, for the purpose of today's session, there is only one portion which is relevant with respect to Clause 15. I will not trouble all of you by reading this particular passage with respect to Clause 15, and we will directly understand as to what remains relevant as far as a Clause 15 or an appeal under Clause 15 is concerned. Under letters patent, especially the Clause 15, which is relevant today, the following judgments, as is understood under letters patent, passed by the High Court in the exercise of appellate jurisdiction in respect of a decree is not appealable. An order made in the exercise of appellate jurisdiction by a court subject to superintendence of the High Court and an order made in the exercise of a revisional jurisdiction. Now, this talks about what are the three kinds of orders which are not appealable under Clause 15. That is one that is passed by the High Court in exercise of its appellate jurisdiction. So if it is going to be a CMA, or if it is going to be an order in the exercise of an appellate jurisdiction by a court subject to the superintendence of the High Court, or if it is going to be in the nature of a CRP. Now, what is appealable? This is the only part which is relevant, which we saw in the previous slide. Only an order which is a judgment within the meaning of Clause 15 is appealable, since Clause 15 confers a right on the litigant to prefer an appeal against a judgment. So till now, while we understand that Clause 15 provides for a letters patent appeal, and we understand as to what will not constitute an appeal, we have yet not understood as to what would constitute a judgment in order for the same to be appealable under Clause 15. So on one hand, we have the CPC, which talks about judgment could be with respect to an order or a decree. And on the other hand, we have the letters patent appeal, which says that only an order which is a judgment in terms of Clause 15 is appealable. Now, again, this has been the problem. And I would say that it is a problem for us in today's generation. But I think in those days, they were pretty clear about what they were doing, irrespective of the fact that it was not defined and a clear definition did not exist at that point in time. Now, when it was initially issued in 1862, the letters patent, which was in existence in 1862, was revoked, and thereafter the 1865 patent came to be. Now, it was understood, even one of the judgments, it was quoted that at that point in time, that the letters patent was issued when the legal procedure and system was in a fluid state of ill-defined uncertainty. This we would find place in one of these judgments as well. And the CPC in force at the relevant point in time was the CPC of, it's not 1859, that needs to be corrected, it's 1858. And at that point in time, it did not contain a definition to the term judgment. It was in the subsequent amendment in, once again, in 1800s, and thereafter in 1908, that you will find the definition of the term order, decree, and judgment finding place in the CPC. Now, moving on, the letters patent was drafted, and this is the crucial part, where in the first slide, the Halsbury Law's definition of an appeal included the term decisions. Now you will see, this is how the practice was at that point in time. The practice was to call the decisions of the Court of Chancery as decrees, the King's Bench as judgments, and the criminal courts as orders. I know that in today's scenario that, you know, we, even from our junior days, I should say that I was guilty of using the term order, judgment, decree in tandem. And I'm not ashamed today to state that I've been using it in tandem, simply because after going through the provisions of CPC and the letters patent, I've come to understand that how difficult it is to even place a definition on the term judgment, which is still, by the way, has not been defined. The subsequent development came when the term judgment came to be synonymous with a decree, but not with an order. As we saw earlier under section 33 of the CPC, I had pointed out that section 33 specifically deals with judgment, that it is as if a stage prior to the matter attaining finality, that is, it is on its way to becoming a decree, but it does not talk about an order. However, the definition section is contrary. But this is what has been discussed in Parnapiya Chettiar versus M.R. Krishnamurthy Chetty, wherein they understood that the term judgment, despite CPC being of the year 1908, having clearly defined this, they said that it has been understood synonymously to be a decree, but not with an order. Now, because there was this prevailing difficulty, as I mentioned before, the earliest of judgments which our Honorable Chief Justice often quotes today in court would be the Justices of the Peace for Calcutta, which started in 1872. I can't believe it's almost going to be 150 years, and this topic is still relevant for this discussion, and more so because there is still a gray area as to what would constitute judgments. Now, this started where they tried to understand the term judgment within the meaning of Clause 15 of the letters patent. And it was an easy job because the judgment which is quoted, which is Justices of the Peace, is barely four paragraphs. And it has given rise to a jurisprudence where we trace back to understand what is a judgment to this particular judgment of Justices of the Peace for Calcutta. And that citation is not there. But in that particular judgment, they also cite this judgment of the Madras High Court, as it then was, of D'Souza versus Coles. Then came the Tulsiram judgment. Can you go back to previous slides? The Tulsiram, okay. So this is where, once the difficulty was understood by the courts, they sought to define the term judgment in order to understand. So where are we in right now in the discussion? We are trying to understand what kind of orders are appealable. Of course, we know that with respect to an original or an appellate decree, there is obviously an appeal which is available. But with respect to orders, what are the kind of orders which are appealable were not clearly defined so as to speak under the CPC, or rather they were not considered to be exhaustive as has been provided under Order 43. So then started the evolution with respect to the jurisprudence. In Central Brokers, they laid down the tests and reiterated the tests of Tuljiram Roe versus Alagappa Chettiar. Now this was the full bench of the Madras High Court in 1935, a beautiful judgment and a must read, which also discusses the justices of the peace judgment, which is four paragraphs. And it rather gives a wider interpretation of what constitutes a judgment for the purpose of Clause 15 of the Letters Patent. Now, the sum and substance of these two judgments were to say, Order 43 is there, no doubt. It is to be read with Section 104 of the CPC, no doubt. But there are certain orders which are appealable, which are still not mentioned in Order 43, but will still be appealable because of the fact that Letters Patent is applicable to the Madras High Court. And then started all these cases when, as and when the situation arose. Next slide, please. With respect to the word judgment, I'm just reading this particular paragraph. The word judgments should not have different meanings in two different statutes so allied to each other as the Letters Patent and the Civil Procedure Code. I can see no great difficulty in this interpretation, for an appeal is in substance one against the statement of reasons underlying a decree or order, though technically it is an appeal against the result embodied in what is called a decree. So here, they in Central Brokers' case, what they try and express is to say that there cannot be a stark difference from what you understand or see from in a Letters Patent, which is to be allied or read contemporaneously with the Code of Civil Procedure. Therefore, they say an appeal can be with respect to something which is a statement of reasons underlying a decree or an order, but then they also acknowledge the fact that it is technically with respect to an appeal against the result which is embodied in a decree. Now, this is where the confusion starts furthermore, and I would say they were rather clear once again about what they were saying, but the confusion starts because in a fact-specific situation, to understand what constitutes a judgment, we need to know what are the orders which are appealable, and there is no exhaustive list as of date. Now, in the context of Letters Patent, to understand more about the term judgment, now CPC talks about the definition of judgment as we saw under Section 2.2, and it provides for appeals against decrees and specific orders which are mentioned under Section 104, read with Order 43. Now, the 1882 code, as I earlier mentioned, the 1858 code did not have the definitions to the term judgment, order, or decree, but it first started in 1882 and thereafter once again finds place in 1908. The courts in the 20th century, however, started interpreting the term judgment, as we saw earlier in Justices of the Peace case, the Central Brokers case, and Tuljiram's case, as early as in 1872. And they focused on the effect. This is where the transformation starts happening. They started focusing on what orders would be appealable, and the test that they wanted to lay down was on the fact that whether the effect on the suit or proceedings, that is the order's effect on the suit or proceedings that could have on the parties, will determine whether an order is appealable or not. So they said, let's not focus on the form of adjudication, but let's clearly concentrate on the effect that it has in the suit or proceedings. This is when the justices of the peace case, which I mentioned earlier, becomes relevant. Judgment in Clause 15 of the Letters Patent means a decision, which these are the words used in the judgment, which affects the merit of the question between the parties by determining some right or liability. So as long as it affects the merits of the question between the parties and it determines the rights or liability between the parties, then it is a judgment. They don't stop with that. They move on and they say it may be final, preliminary, or interlocutory. So this is where it could be final, it could be preliminary, so as to speak that if there is a preliminary question with respect to maintainability of a particular suit, they say that that judgment will be called a preliminary judgment. And that particular judgment, since it affects the rights and liabilities of the parties and the merits in, of the question, it is appealable. They also say interlocutory orders could also be judgments, as we have seen earlier on. And the difference between them being that of a final judgment determines the whole case or a suit. A preliminary or interlocutory judgment determines only a part of it, leaving other matters to be determined. Next, please. Now, what happened is, in Harishchandar Chaudhary, a widest possible interpretation to the term judgment was given. This was in the year 1882. It was held that if a judicial discretion is exercised, now this is very similar to what we see in CRPs, particularly where we challenge it on the basis of jurisdiction. If a judicial discretion is exercised thereunder, it may amount to a judgment, an appeal will lie. If in such exercise of judicial discretion, a judge usurps jurisdiction, that alone would be a valid ground of appeal. Now we saw earlier on as to how justices of peace case spoke about there being three kinds of judgments. Now this gives a wider interpretation to say, if there is a judicial discretion itself, then that particular order will be appealable. But they are narrow in a sense that they say that the only ground available then is with respect to jurisdiction. Now the test to determine a judgment depends upon the effect, as we saw earlier in the Justices of the Peace case and the Tulsirams case. If its effect is to put an end to the suit or proceeding, so far as the court before the proceeding pending is concerned, such an adjudication falls within the meaning of judgment. Now this is what was reiterated in the full bench of Tulsirams case, wherein they said, based on the effect, if it puts an end to the suit or the proceeding. Now the crucial word here is the proceeding. Now see the difference. Earlier we spoke about the Justices of the Peace case talking about three forms of judgment where it could be interlocutory. Then we saw Harishchandra Chaudhary, which speaks about judicial discretion. If that itself is involved, then that is appealable. Then comes Tulsiram, which is aligned to Justices of the Peace case, but they say if it puts an end to the suit or a proceeding, so far as the court before the proceeding pending is concerned, then that adjudication is a judgment. Now this stretches a bit further than the Justices of the Peace case as to the meaning of the term judgment. Now moving on, 1953, again this is one of the oft-quoted judgments by our Honorable Chief Justice. Whenever an appeal is before the Honorable Chief Justice bench, this is the Ashramati Devi's case, which involved the revocation of a leave under Clause 12 of the Letters Patent. Now in that particular case, they laid down the following conditions. The two conditions that are to be satisfied in order that an adjudication results in a judgment. One, they say it should terminate the suit or the proceeding in line with Tulsiram Roe. And two, they say that it should affect the merits of the controversy between the parties to the suit. So on one hand, it should terminate the suit or a proceeding. So a proceeding could be interlocutory. And two, it should affect the merits of the controversy in that particular suit or proceeding. Then it becomes a judgment. This is what the Ashramati Devi says, and even a rejection of revocation of leave to that extent was appealable. There are certain full benches judgments of the Honorable Allahabad High Court, our Madras High Court in 1975. But the other famous case that we are often aware of is the Shah Babulal Khimji's case, 1981 4 SEC, wherein a wider interpretation of the Justices of Peace was also taken into consideration, and the narrow interpretation given by Tulsiram Roe was also taken into consideration, and they tried to lay down an exhaustive list. And this also, while they were also cautious enough to say that this particular aspect, they are not giving a list with respect to as to whether Clause 15 of the Letters Patent is applicable to writ proceedings. But in paragraph 120 of the judgment, they give an illustration of those orders which are appealable under Clause 15 of the Letters Patent. So therefore, in Shah Babulal Khimji's case, they affirmed the idea in 1872 of the Justices of the Peace case, wherein they say there will be three kinds of judgments. So if there is a preliminary judgment, which is in the nature of, like I said, challenging maintainability, a final judgment, of course, and an intermediary or an interlocutory judgment. Now here, this is the crucial part where I wanted to highlight. They said there may be interlocutory orders which are not covered by Order 43, Rule 1, but but which also possess the characteristics and trappings of finality in that the orders may adversely affect a valuable right. So here also they acknowledge that if it is affecting the valuable rights of parties and it puts an end to the controversy, irrespective of whether it is interim or final, then it is a judgment, even though it is not covered by Order 43, Rule 1. Now, this is what Shahab Abulal Khimji's case says. And we'll move on to the next slide. I'll come back to this a bit later. The interlocutory orders which are mentioned in Order 43. Now, Shahab Abulal Khimji's case spoke about these illustrative points or orders to show that these orders are also appealable under Clause 15, which are not specifically there, and they are wider than Order 43 CPC. Pausing here for a moment. Now, if we put the thinking hat on at this point in time, Order 43, Rule 1A, I just read out to all of you that, for example, Rule 1A of Order 43 speaks about a return of plaint. An appeal with respect to a return of plaint is maintainable under Order 43, Rule 1A. Now, let's understand and put these tests which we have seen so far, right up to 1981, and thereafter come to the present scenario. 1981 still holds the field, so let's put that to test. When there is a return of plaint, so there is going to be an application for return of plaint. Now, the return of plaint is not deciding the merits of the issue. It does not put the controversy between the parties to an end, but it determines as to whether the particular court has jurisdiction or it should be presented elsewhere in accordance with the court. Now, I ask myself, how is that particular order with respect to a returning of plaint amounting to a judgment? That has not been discussed in any of these cases so far, but they say Order 43 CPC is there, that provides appealable orders, but apart from it, those are not the only orders which are appealable. There are other orders also which are appealable under Clause 15, provided they satisfy these tests. So as of today, we don't know whether the orders which are specified specifically, or rather, I am not able to comprehend. I won't say we don't know. I would say that I am not able to comprehend as to whether all orders specified in Order 43 will amount to judgments in a fact-specific situation. Now, since I brought this question up, this slide would be more relevant. Now, let's understand whether the following interlocutory orders are judgment for the purpose of Clause 15. An ad interim order granting ex parte stay or injunction. An order suspending the interim injunction by a limited extent. So as to speak that if the interim order is granted and if there is a modification and it is limited to a certain extent than what it was already granted, whether that is appealable. An order setting aside the ex parte decree. An order setting aside the abatement of a suit. Now, all these are situations where if you try and put these tests, that is the tests with respect to whether it affects the merits of the matter, whether it determines the matters of the moment, whether the valuable rights of parties are involved, I would say all these are present in all these four illustrations. But curiously, it can be taken that Supreme Court has held that all these are situations which will not qualify to be an appeal as far as Clause 15 of the letters patent is concerned, of course, in a fact-specific situation. Now, appealable orders under CPC and judgments, I wanted to show that there is some overlap between the orders specified under Order 43 and those judgments which qualify to be appealable under Clause 15. Now, there are some orders, while stating that there are some orders which don't satisfy the tests of judgment under Clause 15, there is some overlap as I see it between. So let's take it for now that there is some overlap between the Order 43 and the letters patent that exists today. Now, there are some orders which do not satisfy the test of judgment. We've been through that. And there are orders which satisfy the test. Again, I've gone through that in the earlier slide itself. Now, let's now jump another 20 years. Given the fact that I promised 40 minutes or 45 minutes, I'm drawing to a close, but I'll try to rush through it. Now, why is this question of understanding what a judgment is relevant is because one of the legislations that we see today with respect to the Commercial Courts Act now has a bar with respect to a letters patent appeal. Now, the Commercial Courts Act itself was constituted, as we all know, to resolve the disputes in a speedy manner akin to the Arbitration Conciliation Act, which is an ADR mechanism, but within the court premises itself where the party approaches the court, and if it is of a specified value, either a commercial court was designated or the division was came into being, and the commercial appellate division could be constituted. Now, this is what is elucidated in these particular sections as to how these commercial courts were created by the state government. Next slide. Now, an appeal under Commercial Courts Act. Now, this is where I would like to draw your attention. An appeal may be preferred by any person aggrieved by the judgment or order of a commercial court. Now, the term judgment or order is used in Section 13 of the Commercial Courts Act. So let's take it that an appeal is preferred by a person against a judgment or an order of a commercial court before the commercial appellate court or the commercial appellate division. The time limit for appeal is 60 days, and the appeal shall lie from such orders passed by the commercial courts or division that are specifically enumerated under Order 43 and Section 37 of the Arbitration and Conciliation Act 96. Next slide. Now, what I wanted to say in the earlier slide was this. Section 13.1 talks about appeals from decrees of commercial courts. So therefore, the heading of that particular section is appeals from decrees of commercial courts and commercial divisions. Now, let's lead further under 13.1, which went through changes and amendments. Any person aggrieved by the judgment or order of a commercial court below the level of a district judge may appeal to the commercial appellate court within a period of 60 days from the date of judgment or order. Now, the heading says, like we've seen the definition of the term appeal under CPC and Halsbury laws, because CPC does not define it. And here we are talking about appeals from decrees alone and not orders. That is what the heading says. One says that an appeal shall lie with respect to a judgment or order by a person within a period of 60 days from the date of judgment or order. So it uses the terms judgment or order. Before amendment, it also used the term decision. And that particular term is not alien, and it was frowned upon by the Honorable Delhi High Court and the Honorable Bombay High Court. And in fact, one of the decisions of our High Court also discusses the aspect of the term decision as it is being loosely worded. But in my humble opinion, I see that the term decision, as I quoted earlier in one of those slides, was very much prevalent during the times of Chancery Court and the King's Bench, and how orders were understood to be akin with criminal courts. Now, 13.1a, this is the crucial part. Any person aggrieved by the judgment, I'm sorry, not 13.1a, that again talks about the appeal from the commercial division to the commercial appellate division, the proviso to 13.1 and 13.1a. Provided that an appeal shall lie from such orders passed by a commercial division or a commercial court that are specifically enumerated under Order 43 of CPC and amended by this Act and Section 37 of the Arbitration Conciliation Act 1996. Now, pausing here for a moment. The heading, like I mentioned, talks about appeals from decrees. 13.1 talks about judgment or orders, but the proviso limits it to saying an appeal shall lie from such orders. It does not use the word only. It does not say provided that an appeal shall lie only from such orders. It says provided that an appeal shall lie from such orders passed by a commercial division or a commercial court that are specifically enumerated under Order 43 of the CPC as amended and Section 37. Now, Order 43, as we understand, like I mentioned in the earlier slides, not all orders under Order 43 would constitute judgments, and they do not satisfy the tests as laid down under Clause 15 of the Letters Patent. Now, this is what we saw in the earlier slides and by way of judgments and precedents. Now, given that scenario, and given the fact that 13.1 and 1A talks about an appeal against a judgment or an order, can we then say this proviso excludes the appeal with respect to the, as we understand, the letters patent appeal, the appeal that is available under the letters patent, is that also excluded? Now, this is as far as the CPC is concerned, but the Commercial Courts Act also applies to Arbitration Act. And I'm sure that there were sessions earlier on, which I was also a part of, wherein I could witness that there were sessions taken with respect to the Arbitration Act. One of the crucial sections under Section 37 of the Arbitration Act relates to those orders which are appealable under the Arbitration Act. This was amended in 2016, which came into effect on 1st January 2016. And there is an exhaustive list today, and no other appeal shall lie. But there is a difference there, and that will be a different topic for discussion. Because unlike a suit, wherein we saw that the judgment becomes a decree, once the award is passed, a challenge to the award lies under Section 34, as we all know, of the Arbitration Act. But Section 36 of the Arbitration Act says that the award shall be enforced as if it is a decree within the meaning of CPC. So the for the purpose of enforcement, it detaches itself from the from the act, and it has to be enforced only in accordance with CPC. Now, why is it relevant? It is relevant here because under the Commercial Courts Act, while they say a particular court shall be designated as a commercial court or a commercial division, they restrict that only such orders are appealable which are mentioned in Order 43 and Section 37 of the Arbitration Act. Now, Arbitration Act is a separate animal. We cannot discuss that today. Now, as far as Order 43 is concerned, we saw earlier that what constitutes a judgment for the purpose of letters patent. Now, let's read 13.2 to understand whether letters patent is specifically excluded. Now, the word specifically excluded gains significance here. Notwithstanding anything contained in any other law for the time being in force or letters patent of a high court, no appeal shall lie from any order or decree of a commercial division or commercial court otherwise than in accordance with the provisions of the Act. Now, food for thought. Again, I do not have the answer for this. I'm just placing it for all of us to think about and ponder over. The heading talks about appeals from decrees, as I repeat again. 13.1 talks about appeals against a judgment or an order. Proviso restricts it to an appeal with respect to Order 43 from those orders which are present in Order 43 of Section 37 of the Arbitration Act. And 13.2 says letters patent appeal is not applicable and such appeal under Clause 15 shall not lie with respect to an order or decree of a commercial division. Now, I ask myself again, I'm not sure whether this is conscious, but I would want to see that the omission is conscious. The omission here being the term judgment. While they have consciously included under 13.1 and 1A, where you can see the underlying portion, where the appeal lies against the judgment or order, in 13.2, they have excluded the term order or decree. So for a moment, if I have to get naughty and mischievous at this point in time, do I then say that an appeal still lies under letters patent appeal, irrespective of this particular clause, which says that as regards an order or decree, a letters patent appeal will not apply. But if it is going to be construed as a judgment within the meaning of the letters patent and also because of its usage under 13.1 and 1A, there are still some orders which are appealable as far as the letters patent appeal is concerned. Now, this thought is fortified only because of what Supreme Court has held with respect to 100A of the CPC and Section 6 of the Specific Relief Act. I'll just come to that. Just you can hold on to this thought. Now, notwithstanding anything contained letters patent, no appeal otherwise than in accordance with the provisions of this Act. This is the non-abstended clause. Now, this is what I discussed with the earlier slide. So therefore, I will not repeat this once again. Now, as regards CPC and Chartered High Courts, I just wanted to point out that under Order 49 Rule 3, there are certain provisions which are excluded and are not applicable to the Chartered High Court. Next slide, please. Now, here, about Arbitration and Conciliation Act. The reason why this particular slide, I just wanted to mention it as a passing reference is because the endeavor under the Arbitration Commercial Act, Conciliation Act, with respect to the amendments that took place in 2015 and thereafter in 2019, the endeavor was with respect to minimum judicial intervention. They laid emphasis on the fact that once it goes for arbitration and an award is passed, there cannot be an appeal and there can only be a challenge to an award. And thereafter, an appeal shall lie under 37 with respect to the award within the four corners and the same tests as applicable and the same grounds are available under Section 34 will also be available under Section 37 of the Act. I'm sorry, there is a mistake in the... Please go back, please. There is a mistake. It is not Section 4. It must be Section 5 of the Arbitration Act, which talks about judicial intervention. So while they use the word Section 37 of the Arbitration Act in Section 13, probably the emphasis is on the fact that, again, there should be minimum judicial intervention and there cannot be a prolonged approach as far as commercial suits is concerned as well. And therefore, they used it along with the term, you know, along with the appeals under Section 37 of the Arbitration Conciliation Act. Now, the appealable orders under 37 are these, that is an order refusing to refer the parties to arbitration. Now, I was just tempted to analyze at this point in time whether these orders would be a judgment by itself and whether they would find place under Order 43. I will just close it at this and say that these will not be applicable. There are some orders which do not find place in Order 43. And therefore, we cannot say that this again is an exhaustive list as regards orders which qualify as judgments in the eyes of law. For the purpose of let us quit. Now I've just drawn a comparison as to those clauses in particular statutes, because the settled proposition of law is letters patent can be excluded by statute. Now there is no quarrel about that, because CPC itself was amended and there was a section 100A which was introduced, like I said, in 1976 with a variation in 2002. Now let's just, we saw 13.2, let's understand 100A. Notwithstanding anything contained in any letters patent for any high court or in any instrument, now these are the words which are missing under 13.2, or in any instrument having the force of law, so probably they mean the letters patent, or in any other law for the time being in force, where any appeal from an original or appellate decree or order is heard and decided by a single judge, no further appeal shall lie from the judgment and decree of such single judge. This is basically means that there cannot be a, say if there is a second appeal coming to the High Court of Madras, there cannot be another further appeal to the division bench from the decree that is passed or the judgment that is passed by the learned single judge. Section 6(3) of the Specific Relief Act specifically excludes, or rather there is a general exclusion. No appeal shall lie from any order or decree passed in any suit instituted under the section, nor shall any review or any such order or decree be allowed. Now pausing here for a moment. Now what the Supreme Court held with respect to a challenge as far as the letters patent is concerned was that in 1998, Supreme Court had an opportunity, and again, a wonderful 5-paragraph judgment by the Honorable Supreme Court. Now this was in the case of Vinita Kanolkar versus Pragya Empire. I'll circulate the citation later, which is 1998, 1 SEC 500. Now what happened here was that they wanted to test this and see whether an LPA appeal would nonetheless lie irrespective of the fact that there is an exclusion under Section 6(3). It does not say specifically letters patent, but it says no appeal shall lie from any order or decree passed in any suit instituted under this section. To me, this is a good enough exclusion. But what the Honorable Supreme Court then felt was that as regards the position of this exclusion, they felt to exclude letters patent, which is specifically conferred on chartered high courts, there must be an express exclusion. So the Supreme Court, so as to speak in shorter words, said, if there is an express saving, there must be an express exclusion, so as to say you are completely excluding letters patent appeal applicability to these particular appeals. So let's take it that now Supreme Court has said, despite these words, LPA is not excluded as far as the High Court of Bombay is concerned. Now again, with respect to Section 50, appealable orders under the Arbitration Act, I will not touch upon this for the moment, because once again, it is just trying to emphasize on the fact that Supreme Court said there shall not be a further appeal. But again, arbitration being a different animal, I will restrict my thought process with respect to judgments with stopping with Specific Relief Act. Now, how should the language be as regards exclusion of the letters patent in order to conclusively state that letters patent appeal is not available at all? Now, Section 4(1) of the CPC says, in the absence of any specific provision to the contrary, nothing in this court shall be deemed to limit or otherwise affect any special or local law now in force, or any special jurisdiction or power conferred, or any special form of procedure prescribed by or under any other law for the time being in force. Now this read with 104(1), an appeal shall lie from the following orders, save as otherwise expressly provided in the body of this court or by any law for the time being in force. Pausing here for a moment. We saw that in the exclusion clause under the Commercial Courts Act, which is Section 13.2, it says that no appeal shall lie with respect to a letters patent unless otherwise it is an order falling under Order 43. But the concluding words of Section 13.2, can you just go back to that slide, or I'll just read it. 13.2 says, no appeal shall lie from any order or decree of a commercial division or commercial court otherwise than in accordance with the provisions of this act. Now, this is very similar to what we see in the code here under Section 104(1). It says, unless otherwise it has been specifically saved by the court, then there shall be no appeal. Now, that is the kind of wording that we see in Section 13.2, so as to suggest that there is some saving provision with respect to a letters patent appeal itself. This is just probably, this has to be tested. The Honorable Delhi High Court has said, yes, a letters patent appeal is available. The Honorable Bombay High Court has said no, there cannot be in specific circumstances that an LPA appeal is not available. This matter has not reached the Supreme Court yet. Our Honorable High Court has already tested this once and said that an appeal is not maintainable. But in a batch of matters which is listed next month, I understand that this particular question is to be argued, and the court is to decide on, the Honorable First Court will be deciding on whether an intra-court appeal will in fact lie. Now, the reason why I'm talking about Section 104 is because of this, these words that I find in Section 13.2. Now, let's see Section 100A. 104 is the saving clause. 100A is the exclusion clause. Notwithstanding anything contained in any letters patent for any high court or in any instrument having the force of law or in any other law for the time being in force. Now, this, in the eyes of the Honorable Supreme Court, would be an express exclusion, and this is settled law that there can be no second appeal. A specific exclusion may be clear from the words of a statute, even though no specific reference is made to the letters patent, once again held by the Honorable Supreme Court. To say that in order for me to understand there is a specific exclusion of the LPA, there needn't be words or references to that effect. A mere inference from the manner in which it is worded is good enough. Then I again ask myself, why is Section 6 of the Specific Relief Act, that particular exclusion, does not tantamount to a specific exclusion? Why is it termed as a general exclusion? It says no appeal shall lie irrespective. So that's another area which bothers me. But where there is an express saving in the statute or section itself, then the general words to the effect that an appeal would not lie or an order will be final are not sufficient. So here they say, this is where I spoke about Section 13.2. There is an express saving as regards the kind of appeals which are available under the Commercial Courts Act. So therefore, it gives rise to a doubt as to whether such judgments are still available to be challenged by virtue of Clause 15 of the Letters Patent. Now, this is what was held in P.S. Sathapan's case in 2004, 11 CC. This I just wanted to point out with respect to the relevance of today's session to writ proceedings, because as has been held by our Honorable High Court, the full bench as late as March 17th, 2021, where they said the provisions with respect to Order 47 or CPC does apply to writ proceedings in certain cases with respect to a review. And then came the writ rules also now, which is now come into the picture. Now, under Order 47, any person may apply for a review of a judgment if he feels aggrieved by a decree and order. We'll skip that. The last bullet, a court may either reject the review. That is, once an application for review is filed, the court may either grant the review or reject the review and rehear the matter. This is what Order 47 Rule 4 says. Now, when the court rejects the application for review, Order 47 Rule 7 says the same is not appealable. So if there is a rejection of a review, because the grounds for review itself is very limited, as we all know. So once there is a rejection of the review, the same is not appealable. Where there is an application for review which is granted, a note thereof shall be made before. Now, this is something I just wanted to point out for all of us to take note once again, because this was news to me. Where an application for review is granted, a note thereof shall be made in the register, and the court may at once rehear the case or make such order in regard to the rehearing as it thinks fit. This is Rule 8. Now, the reason why I say this is important is because of this. And only an order under Rule 4 of Order 47 granting an application of review is an appealable order for the purposes of Order 43, Rule 1W. Only an order which grants an application for review is appealable under Order 43. Now, what does granting mean? We have to look at the previous bullet. When an application for review is granted, a note thereof is prepared and made in the register. Now, therefore, the word suggests granting is not allowing. A grant of a review is only to say that, yes, I will take it on records of the book of the court, and then being a court of record, and then decide whether this review is to be allowed or rejected. But Order 47 Rule 4 says even a mere grant of a review or an application of a review is an appealable order, but does not talk about an order allowing review. So, but the practice and procedure we have all used to hearing is that an order which allows the review is appealable, but an order which is rejecting the review is not appealable. Next slide, please. Now, the writ rules, which was published hardly a month or so back on 36, 2021, incorporates the High Court's power to review being a court of record. This needn't be specifically said, but in the rules it has been said so. Under Rule 29 specifically, it has adopted the grounds mentioned under Order 47 of the CPC with respect to review. Now, why am I talking about review in the aspect of whether it is a judgment or whether it is an whether an appeal is maintainable under letters patent? Next. Now, Shah Babulal Kimji, as I earlier said, the Supreme Court said, I will not decide as to whether the particular judgment applies to a 226 proceedings. It is only the full bench of our Honorable High Court which in District Collector versus Udaipan, where yours truly was also a part representing the state, and I brought this issue up before the Honorable full bench, wherein I stated in the earlier slide we saw, an order rejecting a review is not appealable. Now that is specifically mentioned in Order 47. In this case, interestingly, in District Collector, what happens was that there was an application for review, and then the application was rejected on the ground that there are new grounds which are now produced for which the court, about which the court was not satisfied. And they record all that, they analyze the new fact which has now been produced, and then they reject the application. Now my contention before the Honorable full bench was, if it is going to be the case where a judgment means you are testing the whether rights of parties are affected, if you are testing whether the matter has conclusively come to an end, I have now produced a new fact before the review court. Now the question that came up immediately from the full bench was, but you haven't challenged the original order. Now I had to live with a situation where the state did not file an appeal against the original order, but only filed an appeal against the review. So therefore I said that if it had been the a mere rejection based on the grounds that are available for review, I do not have a case. But as regards the particular issue on hand, that is whether an appeal lies with respect to a rejecting of a review, normally no appeal lies, but in a fact specific situation where I have introduced new facts, the court has applied its mind and thereafter rendered a decision, that decision becomes a judgment. This was my submission, and the same was accepted by the Honorable full bench, and they went to the extent of saying that the rights of parties could not be curtailed and the term judgment has to be liberally interpreted. Now these are the principles which were laid down, and the one of the keen pointers or takeaways from this is that the Suprema Lex confers such recognition of high courts being courts of record, and is elementary that it inheres in a court of record to review orders, if only to preserve the purity of its records and to prevent miscarriage. So this was the object based on which the Honorable full bench felt, if there is an error and if a new fact is provided and it is rejected considering that fact, then that constitutes a judgment because there is consideration and application of merit. Now these were the principles that were laid down by the Honorable full bench. Article 215 of the Constitution makes every high court a court of record, as we just saw. Article 225 of the Constitution preserves the authority of the existing high courts at the time of commencement of Constitution. And like an appeal, this is the crucial part, which is a creature of a statute, the power to review does not inhere in any adjudicatory body unless it is conferred or it has historically enjoyed the same, and the history in such regard is preserved. Since both the history pertaining to the Chartered High Court and the recognition conferred by Article 215 of the Constitution permit the High Court to be regarded as a court of record, the power of review comes along with it. In addition, the authority to review orders passed under 226 may be found in such constitutional provision itself. Thus, even it is accepted that nothing in the code applies to proceedings. So even they went to the extent of saying, let's assume this was before the advent of the writ rules, 2021, which came into effect on 36. They said nothing in the code applies to proceedings under 226 of the Constitution. The power of review has to be traced to both the plenary jurisdiction conferred by Article 226 of the Constitution and the status of the high courts as the courts of records as recognized in Article 215. In this particular case, I had the opportunity of presenting to the Honorable full bench about the evolution of law with respect to the justices of the peace case, and that is the reason why they also felt we cannot draw down an exhaustive list with respect to what are appealable orders which would constitute judgments. Now these are broad principles which I already spoke about, which the full bench laid down with respect to an appealability of an order in a review. I think that's the happy slide at the end of the day. I'm sorry, I've crossed the limit that I had originally promised. But I'm immensely grateful and thankful to Mr. Om Prakash once again, senior counsel. And once again, my apologies, sir, for delaying this particular session. I'm open to questions if at all there are any. But I'll have more questions than answers to give as far as this topic is concerned. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, speaker. And it had been a wonderful session. It is really a worth the wait we had taken for you for all these things. And thought-provoking session in terms of what requires to be done by an advocate as to analyzing various aspects. You have gone in depth as to the definition of judgment and order and decree. And it is very useful. I think members of the bar should be really useful. But I have one question before anybody can start. The Commercial Courts Act Section 13(1)(a) provisio speaks about orders which are provided under Order 43 of CPC. Then it says the words, as amended by this act, that it uses the word specifically.
The provision
as amended by this act.
Yes.
What kind of difference it has made to that Order 43 in the amendment of Commercial Courts Act? Is there any exclusion? One thing which I found was that I couldn't specifically find the amendment to Order 43.
No. They just wanted to leave room, which is why, sir, this is again a point where I was talking about what judgments would be construed as judgments for the purpose of LPA. Now here, like you rightly pointed out, if they are talking about as amended by this act, they are saying that there is scope for those orders which are considered to be appealable orders to be expanded. Now, how will it expand? It can either be by an act of parliament where they are going to amend the court and introduce some other orders, or it could be by way of judgments. Therefore, I feel once again, the judgment as understood as, or rather the courts to understand, should be more in the line of saying that, yes, there is an appeal which is available under the LPA because there is a judgment which is already passed by the lower court, thereby not declining an intra-court appeal. I would rather interpret it more leniently to say that since they have specifically said as amended by this act, they are going to allow, or rather, the act is not conservative in that sense, where they contemplate that the Order 43 could be expanded.
And your point was also on the words used, saying that it was only using a word order.
Correct.
Orders which are set out in Order 43.
Correct.
The concept of judgment is still open.
Yes.
The moment you are able to bring about any decision as a decision of a judgment within the definition or within the law has been laid down by Supreme Court, then still it is open for an intra-court appeal.
Correct. Now, the reason more so is because of 13(2), which says that 13(1) and 1A uses the term an appeal shall lie from a judgment or order. But the clause which excludes LPA only excludes no appeal shall lie from any order or decree. It does not say no appeal shall lie from any order which becomes a judgment.
Yes.
Because obviously, a decree is, as far as that discussion is concerned, is closed. Obviously, it is appealable.
And just one more point of discussion. It's not a query or a doubt which I am raising is, the march of law is in the nature that they wanted to curtail more of appeals. Is it correct?
As far as commercial matters are concerned, yes, because as we understand, that is the reason why I said probably they have combined Arbitration Act to a Commercial Courts Act only because they say the new act, rather the new Arbitration Act as it has been amended in 2015, those also will fall under the commercial division of the commercial court. Therefore, an appeal shall lie in the nature where it is provided under Section 37 only, so as to reiterate the point that there should be minimum judicial intervention so that there is less time spent in courts in appeals.
Thank you very much. Yeah, we will leave it open to the forum. Any member who wants to raise any query can use the raise hand option, or you can also post it in the chat box, which Mr. Shivashanmugam would read out to the person.
No, I think I've managed to confuse a lot.
Not at all.
That is why I said there'll be more questions than answers. Even for me, I can retort with a question. More than
in fact, one Mr. Murugesan has said it's a fantastic presentation and a super explanation, sir.
Right. Was
obviously well received. On behalf of Study Circle, I would like to request you, sir, Can you share the PPT so that we can circulate it to the group, sir?
Sure, my pleasure. I'll ask my colleague to just circulate.
I think fairly that's true.
I think there's no more questions. I think the session was very informative. So I call upon Mr. Shivashamugam, Advocate Madras High Court, to render the vote of thanks for this session.
Good evening, and thank you, sir, for a wonderful session. Your PPT and comparison table showed the amount of work you have put in to make it so clear to us. And it also showed the seriousness in your preparation. The way you explained the difference between the order and judgment and the appeal, quoting the various provisions, we are happy to have you on board. And we thank you for the wonderful session, sir. With these kind words, this marks the end of the session of the study circle. And I thank all the participants who have participated on this day. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thanks a lot for the opportunity.